Welcome to week 8. Last week we wrapped up Gaussian elimination. We added row pivoting in order to overcome an element on the diagonal, which we often call a pivot element, to avoid the situation where that element is zero. And then we moved on and we talked about the inverse of a matrix, and we looked at a string of simple matrices that we had encountered, and we talked about how to find the inverse for those matrices. Now hopefully you understand the notion of an inverse. And what we're going to talk about this week is a systematic way of computing that inverse. Now, the interesting thing is that at the end of it all, I'm going to try to convince you to not compute the inverse of a matrix in real situations. It's just not how it's typically done, except for very small matrices. Now, that doesn't mean that what we're going to do this week is kind of a useless exercise. What this exercise does is it reinforces your understanding of Gaussian elimination. It reinforces your understanding of inversion of a matrix. It reinforces your understanding of how the unit basis vectors fit into the picture. So in general, it actually has some benefits in other ways. And obviously, learning that you shouldn't do things that other people teach people to do is in itself a useful thing to know. Now, this week is a relatively light week. The reason for this is that next week we will have our midterm. So we're wrapping things up that you need to know for the midterm. That way you can then spend some time getting ready for that midterm. And there is also a strong component in the enrichment section this time that hopefully you will find time to explore. We'll now get started with week 8. So the first thing we're going to do is link Gaussian elimination with row swaps to the existence of the inverse of a matrix. Now, remember, Gaussian elimination with row swaps is the same as LU factorization with row swaps or LU factorization with row pivoting. These are all one and the same thing for all practical purposes. So if one fails, the other fails. Okay. In order to do this, we're first going to establish the following. If we have a matrix A, that's the matrix with which we, for example, start LU factorization with partial pivoting, and we apply some matrix to it, we saw that LU factorization was the same as applying a Gauss transform from the left to the matrix to introduce zeros. Then this original matrix A and the resulting matrix C have the property that if A is non-singular, then C is non-singular and vice versa. And what that means is that if somewhere along the lines LU factorization with partial pivoting yields a matrix that itself is not non-singular, in other words, doesn't have an inverse, then we know that the original matrix did not have an inverse. So how does this go? Well, the theorem says A is non-singular if and only if C is non-singular. There's a homework associated with this. So if you want to prove this to yourself first, then take a break right now and just come back and I'll walk you through it. Everyone else can just stick with me and we'll move ahead. So what's going on here? We're going to first prove that if A is non-singular, then C is non-singular. And the way you prove that is you say, okay, well, assume that A is non-singular. At that point, we know that B is non-singular, and we know that A is non-singular. Therefore, both have inverses. Therefore, this matrix right here exists. But if you look at A inverse B inverse times C, that's the same as A inverse times B times A, because that's how C was related to A and B. And we notice that this is the identity and this is the identity, and therefore that is the identity. But what that means is that we have constructed a matrix such that if you multiply it times C, you get the identity. And what that means is that C has an inverse. After all, we have constructed it. By the way, here we assume that all matrices are square, otherwise some of these arguments don't actually hold. So let's move on. Let's now assume that C is non-singular. And notice that because B is non-singular, we see that A is equal to B inverse C. Why? We know that B times A is C, but we can then multiply both sides by B inverse. That then means that that is the identity. And that means that A is equal to B inverse times C. If we look at this matrix right here, and we multiply that times A, then what we get is C inverse B, B inverse C because of this. This here is the identity. This here is the identity. Therefore, get the identity. And what we've done is we've constructed the matrix such that if you multiply it times A, you get the identity. But what that means is that A has an inverse, namely this matrix. So we now know that A is non-singular if and only if C is non-singular. Let's see how we're now going to use this. Well, the way this works is that we start with some matrix and we start doing LU factorization, or in this case, we're going to look at it as applying pivot matrices and Gauss transforms to the matrix, and we saw that that was equivalent. Okay, so we compute some kind of permutation matrix. Now we know that it is non-singular because we know how to construct its inverse. It's the transpose. And then we can compute a Gauss transform such that we get a matrix that now has zeros in the first column below the diagonal. Okay, then we move on. We compute another permutation matrix. We compute another Gauss transform, and we get this matrix right here. Now notice that if this matrix is non-singular, then this matrix is non-singular by the argument we just had. And if that matrix is non-singular, then the original matrix is non-singular. So anytime we end up with some matrix along the way, if that matrix is non-singular, and then the original matrix was non-singular, and if that matrix is singular, then the original matrix is singular. That's what this theorem that we just proved says. Now, LU factorization with partial pivoting, or this whole process with pivoting and Gauss transforms, can run into the situation where you have a zero on the diagonal. What happens then? Well, you look at the elements below it, and you try to find one that is non-zero, and then you swap the appropriate rows. When does this break down? This breaks down if all of the elements below that zero are also zero. Then you can't find a row with which to pivot, with which to swap. So the question now is it the case that this matrix here doesn't have an inverse? Because if that's the case, then we can reason that the original matrix did not have an inverse. Now, how do we reason that? This is the general form of the matrix when LU factorization with partial pivoting breaks down, when this whole process that we just described breaks down. And here we're using a hat for the original matrix, although it seems like sometimes I forget that hat. So if we can show if the matrix has this special form, then the matrix doesn't have an inverse, then we know that the original matrix had a problem. We have this long list of equivalent statements about A. Let's say if A is non-singular, then all of the other ones have to hold as well. What I'm going to show is that this matrix with this special structure has the property that we can construct a non-zero X that maps to zero when multiplied by that matrix. And what that means is that that matrix then is not non-singular. Because if it were, then only the zero vector could map to the zero vector. So here's that matrix with that very special form. And what I'm doing here is I'm constructing a vector X that I'm going to show maps to zero. Now, if this is the first situation where this happens, where we cannot find a row with which to pivot, this matrix right here must be an upper triangular matrix with no zeros on the diagonal. Otherwise, we would have encountered this problem before. An upper triangular matrix that doesn't have a zero on the diagonal, we saw, has an inverse. Therefore, this vector right here exists. Notice that we placed a 1 in the vector right there. Therefore, the vector can't possibly be B, the zero vector. If you multiply this out, you get this. You get that times that plus this times that plus that times 0. That gives you this right here. And then this times that plus 0 times that plus this times 0 is just 0. And this times that plus this times that plus this times that gives you a 0 right there. But this here is the identity. And you then notice that the minus u01 plus u01 cancels. And what you end up with is the 0 vector. So we've constructed a vector x such that if you multiply it by this matrix that you end up with if LU factorization with partial pivoting breaks down, we have constructed a vector x that then maps to 0 when multiplied by that matrix. And what that means is that that matrix cannot have an inverse, and therefore, by the theorem we proved earlier, the original matrix cannot have an inverse. Okay, so if this matrix cannot have an inverse, which we just showed, then the original matrix cannot have an inverse. So how does that manifest itself? Well, to determine whether a matrix has an inverse, one thing you can do is run LU factorization with partial pivoting. And if it's ever the case that when you try to determine with what row to pivot, there is no row with which you can pivot, then you know that this whole process of LU with partial pivoting fails. And what that means is that the original matrix must have been such that it doesn't have an inverse. And that's summarized right here. Let's review. We started with Gaussian elimination without pivoting. Then if that failed, we introduced the notion of row pivoting. And now what we see is if that fails, then the original matrix did not have an inverse. And notice that solving with a matrix that doesn't have an inverse is inherently a problem. And we're going to look at how to deal with that problem during subsequent weeks in this course.